church today in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I greet you all. I greet you all. To love you. Hallelujah. If there are people that are here with us today for the first time, I'd like to welcome them. Amen. If you are here for the first time, please raise your hand wherever you are seated. I gave us an give God a hand of praise, please. Let us share the word of God from the book of Genesis chapter 12 verse 1 and Exodus chapter 14 verse 13. Today we're going to, I've got a long topic there, but we are talking a different message than we preached in the morning. Amen. If somebody has found Genesis chapter 12 verse 1, please read it for us.
Genesis chapter 12 verse 1. The Lord had said to Abraham, go from your country, your people and your father's household to the land I will show you. 2. I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. 3. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you.
Amen.
Okay, now let's read Exodus chapter 14, verse 13. If you have found it, say amen.
Exodus chapter 14, verse 13. That day the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. 31. And when they
came, 13, 1, 3.
Oh, 13. I'm sorry. 13. Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring to you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will see them no more. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still.
Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. This is your word. I pray in the name of Jesus that, Lord, it may be familiar words, but Lord, we know that you've got a different revelation and a different anointing. I pray for every heart and every soul that is listening in this place today. Bless them, O Lord, and feel them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. We have read two scriptures. The first one is where we're reading about Abraham. It is God speaking to Abraham. He said, Abraham, leave your father's country and go to the land that I will show you. Because not every time God tells us where he's taking us. Not every time God tells us what we're going to meet on the way. But anything that God does not mention is not worth mentioning. If there's anything that you meet on the road where God has told you to go, it's because it was not worth the mention. Now he says,
Abraham,
I will make you great. It's like he said, I don't want to make you great here. I want to make you great there. Because here is your father's country. When you become great, people will start to claim ukuthi umalume wakho kusizi.
But
people will start to claim what he was banbani
Wednesday.
But I want to take you where you are not known. Whereby nobody can claim that it is me that contributed. I want to take you to an unfamiliar environment. You will be great in an unfamiliar land. You will make it in the foreign country. You will make it in strange circumstances. Because I am the God who uses whatever I want. I am the God who uses whoever I want. I show up anywhere, anyhow. I am not limited by the support you have. Amen.
Hallelujah.
It's like he said, here there are people who have got too much of your record. While I start to use you, there may be people who start to tell you, who do you think you are? And start to remind you of your weaknesses. And start telling you that not you. People who are great, they do not start like you started. People who become great, they don't fail maths like you're failing. People who become great, they are not changing relationships like you're changing. It's like God says, I want to take you out of the place that will limit your abilities. I want to take you out of the place where you're going to hear things that will limit you from moving. Because when God wants to use you, he takes you out and puts you somewhere. Before God started to bless Israel, he had to take them out and put them somewhere. Am I with somebody? When you see things that you're familiar with start disappearing, do not blame anybody. Do not blame yourself. You are not losing them because you have done wrong. It's because God wants to remove you. He wants to eliminate you from familiar environment. Because God cannot use you with the familiar environment. Can I talk to somebody in this place? There are people that leave you, and the fact that they are leaving you is not because it's your fault. It's not because there are things you did not do. It's because God is about to use you. There are relationships that God will remove from you before he starts to use you. Because there are relationships that will drain you, that you don't see the power of God, that you don't see the grace of God. But there are times whereby God wants to take you out of the family support. When God will take out things that have been supporting you for years, because he wants to show you that is bigger than any support, that is bigger than anything that you have been leaning on. He wants to show you that is a God that you can trust. In the midst of any support, in the midst of any other support, God wants you to know how greater is he that is in you. Isolation from workplace, isolation in business, isolation in the house. Have you ever been alone? Then you ask yourself, what did I do? It is because it's about time. My God says, I'm taking you out of your father's house. I'm taking you out from the familiar environment. I'm taking you somewhere where my blessing works. I'm taking you somewhere where my stuff works. Now, last week, we spoke about your enemy shall release you. We said your enemy will say, go leave us. We said your disease will say, leave us. If you live in a shack, the shack will say, leave us. If you live in poverty, poverty will say, leave us. Go out. We cannot handle you anymore.
So
now we are moving out of the father's country. Now Egypt had to leave the familiar environment for them to see God. They had to leave the daily bread that was coming from Pharaoh and go to the daily bread that will come from God. And there are times whereby people that used to will say, leave us. Not that they hate you,
it's all about you.
Because you are delaying them. In fact, you are causing disaster where they are. And now they release you. They say, leave us. Those are the times of the next level. Those are the times of promotion. So Egypt says, Israel, come back. Israel, take everything you have.
Israel,
and leave us. Alright? Yeah. So we ended it there. And now I want us to follow it up. That after they left, when they were celebrating, when they were writing on Facebook, checking
in.
Past the mountain so and so. Out of Egypt. While they are busy telling others, I'm out. Then they met the Red Sea. Hallelujah. So a Red Sea is that stage that takes away your excitement. Now a Red Sea is that stage that takes away your testimony. When you have already celebrated, what's a tell this and your girlfriend?
What tell this and your girlfriend?
What if somebody who told us that? Let me tell you, told us this was yalu.
Tell me if you mind, told yalu.
Hallelujah. Imagine you hit a Red Sea. Red Sea limits your pace. Red Sea takes away your testimony. Red Sea takes away your excitement. Somebody say Red Sea. When you meet a Red Sea, God knows that there is a Red Sea where you're going. God knows that before Canaan, there is a Red Sea somewhere. And God has made a plan. There is something that will happen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But before something happens, the Egyptians started to change their minds.
They
said, okay. See, how they are celebrating now. Let us show them. Let us go and get them back here.
Amen.
The Red Sea decided. Egyptians decided. Moses, what do we do now? Do I have somebody in this place who is saying, after celebrating so much, after giving so much, after tithing so much, after fasting so much, I'm stuck right now? Let's see this side. Egypt this side.
Hallelujah.
God, I am tired, Jehovah. Sometimes he waits for us to be in the corner before he starts to react. Sometimes he keeps crying while the Egyptians are packing up their weapons coming for us. God keeps crying. And I saw the Lord speaking to Moses. Say, Moses, tell the people that the Egyptians that they see behind them, they shall see them no more. At that time, the sea is right here. God is talking. God knows how to talk. When there is no solution, God knows how to talk. When you do not know what's going to happen, God said, tell the Egyptians, tell Israel, that the Egyptians kings are growing is to hold on to what he's saying. Even though it's not working,
that is as if
what we're holding on to is to hold him, is to hold him accountable to what he's saying. Start looking back. I don't know what is it that is threatening you, but I'm here to tell you that God said, the Egyptians you see, you will see them no more. How are they going to disappear? I do not know. What's going to destroy them? I do not know. But what I know is that the Master has spoken. Open about. They've just been told
by
the Egyptians, you see, you will see them no more, but they came closer.
Hey,
they just received the word. But they start to say, maybe there are 10,000 angels coming. No, the Egyptians are coming closer. Oh, hallelujah. But I love God because he is waiting for your enemy to be close enough for
a
miracle to happen. Don't panic. That enemy is still too far. God is waiting for them to be close enough. So when they were close enough, then God started to open up the sea. The sea started to talk to each other. The water started to talk to the water. Saying, hey, water upstream, please don't come. Wait there. Let us wait for God's people to pass by. The word that created us is passing now. Because Egypt was close enough, they followed very close. When Israel was going out, Egypt was inside. And they drowned in the water. Watch this. There's something significant here. That when God wants to separate you from your past to where you're going, he will provide something like a Red Sea. Because the Red Sea was stopping between their Egypt and their wilderness. So there will be things that God will put not to frustrate you, but to close doors permanently behind you. Those things, when you look at, they will look like they were a frustration. They will look like people are unreasonable. They will look like people are unfair. But it was the door that God wanted to close behind you permanently. This sounds like baptism. Baptism is whereby you have been born again. Whereby you've been delivered from Egypt. But your Egypt will come after you within no time. When you've been delivered from a cigarette. Until Amen. When you've been delivered from Heineken. When you've been delivered from what they have seen, yes, Baba Bantu. Ishon Penanizas. When you've been delivered, ever as the Nigopi, so look at the Masari. Even.
Nyaope.
Yeah, when you've been delivered, we are open.
Also look at the Nyaope.
What is our very challenge?
They were so Tamahayan.
Oh, I saw you much celebrate and such a.
How do you live again?
And you were born again. But when you go to sleep,
in Paolo Lang,
in Yalbert, yay, come on to clever.
Yeah,
let's see how far you can go. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, the only thing that saves you from Nyaope coming back is for you to go through the Red Sea.
It's
for you to go through the water. Because when you get baptized, you get into the water. And the Nyaope that has been following you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Is
Salamati.
And he is Salamita.
Hallelujah.
Also, Baba Sabonis. We are one of the Baba Sidis one.
I want us to close.
You have got Abonia Obewak,
Nadia Petaham.
You have got Amakes's work,
Tanti Trapota Hound.
Bound. Word bound means you cannot do what you want when you want. Whether you want to be free,
when I'm at a
you were created to worship. But look at you now. You are bound. You cannot worship. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So now the Bible says, if the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. The Bible says, behold the Lamb of God that takes away all the sin of the world. Because when Jesus comes to you, he takes your load upon himself and makes you to be free that you can worship. Oh, hallelujah. God takes away every pain you ever had. He takes away every curse you ever had. And he puts it upon himself. And he says, now you are free. If the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. Any free people in here? Are there any free people in here? Shout, I am free. Shout, I'm free. Move like you are free. Move like you are free.
Oh,
yes. Now, those curses are not yours anymore. Because the Lord has come and has done what? He has taken. You know the meaning of take. It means each one was not with him before. And he has taken away the sin of the world. So where is your sin now? It is on Jesus. I will tell you, we'll talk more about what happens after that. That's not my point. My point was, now that you have left these things, and now you are peaceful, then the devil starts to come. When it's dark, when nobody's watching. You should have fully won, Hallelujah. What's up, plan again? Hey, when you're serious, when you say you're born again, phone call say, I know it's fire, born. Let's just have a drink.
that friend that you've called and say, hey, just one thing. You drink water, it's fine. You drink water. Just come, let's enjoy drinks together. I've got water.
Don't feel like I'm more meat if I get to have.
I do very send a sugar in this room. This is what baptism does. Baptism is when you are having all those things. Take your things. And we take you to the water. And when we take you to the water, we baptize you in the name of the Father. And make you come out in the name of the Son. And come out in the name of the Holy Spirit. When you come out, you left all those things in the Red Sea. And you are on the other side of the Red Sea. They will find you no more. They are not alive anymore. And they will never be found in you anymore. Because if the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. Give God a prayer of praise for the Red Sea. We thought that the Red Sea was here to frustrate us. But we do not understand that the Red Sea was there to take away. Wilderness is that place whereby you're not feeding from Pharaoh anymore. But you are feeding from God Himself.
Amen.
Oh, yes.
Wilderness is that place whereby you must supply. Does not come from your strength anymore. But he says, I will supply all your needs according to my riches and glory. Wilderness is a place whereby manna comes every day. It doesn't matter what you do or do not do. Our daily prayer is coming. Families, they even make terms. Today it's you to go and get manna for all of us. Today it's you. Hallelujah. 7 o'clock. Families are going to collect manna. What did they pay? Nothing.
Little.
What did they do? Nothing.
Little.
But God supplies without you doing anything. It's time of grace. So in our journey of Christianity, there are times to work hard, but there are times of grace whereby God supplies without you doing anything, without you dying and bleeding. He just supplies anyway. Tell your neighbor, He supplies anyway. Oh, there are times whereby you don't have to impress Him, whereby you don't have to whereby you don't have to introduce yourself. He just gives you manna. Oh, hallelujah. Whereby you don't have to show your certificate. He just gives manna. Times of grace. Times of mercy. Time for God to supply. Tell your neighbor, I see God supplying for you. Oh, is there anybody who has been delivered from Egypt? Wilderness is not there to kill you, but wilderness is there to see the grace of God. The manna, that manna in the flower, flowers got manna, got flowers somewhere. But now God does not employ people to mix manna. He makes it Himself. He gives you a ready product. There are